going, guys? We just got off our live stream, and I'm going to try this again. As you saw yesterday, and you probably already heard the video I made for our last lecture, the music was way too loud. So played around with the settings, and I think this is going to work a lot better. So this is take two. let's jump right into it. Today we're going to be talking about, again, chapter 46 on animal reproduction. And as I've kind of said in the live stream, this is a really fascinating topic for me. Always has been, and I hope you get something out of this. So jumping over to the PowerPoint, here we go. The first thing we want to talk about when we look at animal reproduction is understand that there are different ways to reproduce. And the two ways are through asexual and sexual reproduction. Now this is going to be a really quick recap because you guys already know a lot of this. In asexual reproduction, we don't need a partner. And so that means that the pro and con of it is that you don't need to find a mate, right? So if you're reproducing asexually, you can just decide when it's time to reproduce. You have plenty of nutrients and space. You're basically going to clone yourself. But the downside of that is you're going to have reduced genetic variation. A couple different types of asexual reproduction that we see in nature. One is binary fission. Who does binary fission? You should know this by now. It's bacteria. Binary fission is a form of mitosis that bacteria use. They copy all their DNA, and then they basically split that one cell into two, making two clones of each other. Of course, during that process, they do get genetic variation by getting mutations, but that's going to have to accumulate over many, many generations. Another example is something called budding. We see this in a lot of plants, and some animals actually do this too, where they can actually for these animals it's just invertebrates, but they can grow like a new individual kind of off to the side, and eventually that can either break off or it just kind of becomes a separate individual and they kind of live in a cluster together. You can see these sea anemone here, these cnidarians. A lot of cnidarians actually use budding. Hydra is another one that is a cnidarian. They just basically grow like a new little baby hydra off to the side, and that becomes another individual. Another example is fragmentation. This is seen in worms. You probably have heard that you can take worms and cut them into pieces. Each one will grow into a different worm. And that's not always true. It only happens to a certain extent, depending on the species of it. But the ones that do it, because they're segmented, and those segments are the way they regulate their genes is that all those segments have the capability of turning on genes and growing into a new individual, you can see fragmentation happen in very few animals. But worms, lumbriculus worms are capable of doing that. Finally, we have regeneration. This is not really a type of reproduction, but this is more about replacing limbs or body parts that have been lost. Obviously, we can't do that. If you lose your arm, it's gone. You just have that nub. But some animals, like sea stars and lizards, you may be familiar, when one of their arms breaks off or their tail breaks off, in lizards, their tail breaks off, they're able to regenerate that by going through mitosis of those stem cells. Again, it's not really a type of asexual reproduction because you're not making a whole new individual, but it kind of falls in a similar category. Now, asexual organisms in general are going to have features of being sessile, meaning that they kind of stay in one place, and they also tend to be really isolated because they don't really need any mates. In addition to that, their strategy with reproduction is because they don't need a mate, they can crank out a lot of offspring in a very short amount of time. And a great example of that would be bacteria, right? Bacteria, in a couple of hours, can divide millions of times, and they can grow in their population size very effectively. On the flip side, you have sexual reproduction. This is where two haploid gametes are going to come together to make a diploid zygote. And you're all pretty familiar with this, so I want to give you some examples of special cases. One is something called hermaphroditism, or hermaphrodite organisms. Worms are actually an example of this. What this means is that they're sexual, but individuals have both male and female parts. Now, this doesn't mean that they can reproduce with themselves. That would be kind of defeating the whole purpose of sexual reproduction, which is to get genetic variation. So they still have to find a mate, but a lot of worms can play both the roles of males and females. And you may remember the video I showed you guys about flatworms and platyhelminthes doing the penis fencing. That would be another case of hermaphroditism. A really cool example here is parthenogenesis. In some species, and this is like in fish, and I think some amphibians can do this, what happens sometimes is the ratio of males to females is really, really thrown off. And if you end up in a population where everybody's a male, or most of them are males, or most of them are females, parthenogenesis is a process where an individual, sometimes it's an alpha male or alpha female, or sometimes it's stimulated by like physical touch and that can trigger hormones, but they can actually change their gene regulation and change their biological sex. And so if they're all males around and there's no females to mate with, one of the males, I forget if it's male to female or female to male, I'll have to check, but they will be able to turn on the hormone and turn on a gene like the SRY gene and basically turn into the male can turn into a female or vice versa. And in this case, these fish here, the males and females are actually different colors. So when that fish changes its sex, it not only changes its internal physiology, but the external features actually literally changes colors, and that signals to all the other fish that they're a member of the other gender. Now with fertilization, sexual reproduction can happen in two ways. You can have external fertilization as well as internal fertilization. We do not do external fertilization, right? External fertilization means that you're gonna basically lay your eggs and then the sperm gets sprayed on top of that. And the requirement for that is to have a lot of moisture. And that's why external fertilization really only happens with animals that live in the water. A lot of invertebrates, fish, and even some amphibians, they're going to use external fertilization. That's going to allow them to make a lot of gametes because the female doesn't have to carry the eggs inside and then become pregnant. So she's going to be able to put more energy and space into producing gametes and release all those. And so you can see in this picture here, these frogs are going to lay hundreds of eggs at once as they do fertilization. Now, the downside of this is because the eggs are out in the open, the parents aren't protecting them. And so not all of these offspring are going to survive. So you're going to have lower survivorship with very little parental care. You're going to learn about this in ecology, but environmental science and ecology, what we call these organisms are type R organisms. What that means is that they've adopted an evolutionary strategy of having as many kids as possible, but they don't really provide a lot of parental care, and the survivorship is pretty low. It doesn't really stabilize until they get older. Now with internal fertilization, this is a major adaptation to moving onto land. You guys remember when we move onto land, we can't really lay eggs out in the open anymore and spray them with sperm because both the sperm and the eggs are going to dry out very quickly. And so what we can do is basically internalize that whole process by having the process of sex take place, right? Where the penis is inserted into the vagina and the sperm is released and fertilization happens internally. And what that does is it keeps everything moist so that they don't dry out, and that provides a opportunity for higher survivorship. Now, the downside of this is obviously because this is happening inside, that means you're gonna have fewer gametes and fewer offspring. And that's why when you look at a frog versus a dog or a human, the clutch size, the number of kids in each set of reproduction is gonna be a lot fewer in these organisms. But they're gonna make up for that by providing a lot of parental care, and that's gonna lead to high survivorship. In the ecology, we call this a K-type strategist. All right, now the part of the body that actually produces and stores and delivers the gametes are called the gonads. Gonads are the organs like the ovaries and the testes that produce the gametes. Now, through the animal kingdom, there's a whole wide array of like how complex these gonads are, but the more complex they become, generally speaking, we see a lot more tubes and glands that get added to that. And what those tubes and glands add are, number one, we have tubes that are highly folded. That means you have more surface area, which means you have more space to produce your gametes. We're also gonna have glands that add accessory fluids that add nutrients or help to neutralize acids. We're gonna see some examples of that when we look at the human systems. And then a big adaptation or feature that gets evolved is the uterus, which allows not only for the gametes to be stored, but actually when animals become placental and they start carrying their babies inside, that actually provides a place for the embryos to be housed. These complex systems carry, nourish, and protect gametes, and they also can house developing embryos, which we're going to see in the human uterus. Speaking of the uterus, let's go ahead and take a look at the reproductive systems. I know I'm going kind of quickly, but it's my second go, so I'm not trying to spend too much time on this. This is obviously going to be a female human reproductive system, but if you were to look at most mammals, you're going to see pretty much the same structures inside. Obviously, you guys know that the ovaries are responsible for producing and storing that egg. It's actually going to get nourished inside the structure called the follicle. We'll talk about that later. And then the egg's going to be released through the process of ovulation. And then the follicle has a really important role. We'll talk about that later on. Don't worry about that for now. And then you have the uterus, which houses the embryo. And then the vagina, which is the opening to the outside world. And that is where sperm can be deposited. And this is also going to serve as the birth canal. So let's zoom in and take a closer look at all these structures here. In this picture here, we are looking at, just to orient you, the right side here is anterior, so this is towards the front, and then this is posterior, this is towards the back, and you can see the buttocks right there. So towards the front, here are your structures. This is the pubic bone right here, and then directly behind that, you have not the uterus, but the bladder. So this is the bladder, and this light little tube here that comes out, that's the urethra, so that's where you pee from. Here are the labia, major and minor labia that open up to the vagina, and here you can see the vaginal structures. At the very back of the vagina, you have the structure here called the cervix, and you can see if you look closely, there's a tiny little hole right there. That hole is the cervix. That's where the sperm are going to have to travel into if they're going to want to be able to get to the ovaries and the eggs. That opening in the cervix also leads to this big muscular, it's small right now, but eventually can become really big, but this muscular organ here, this is the uterus. Okay, and you can see all that red lining, all the striations in there. That's all muscle that, if the woman gets pregnant, is going to be used to, one, stretch out to accommodate the baby, but then also contract and squeeze during the delivery process. You can see above the uterus, you have this tube coming out, and there's actually two tubes. This is a frontal view. And at the top, going to the left and to the right, you have the fallopian tubes, and each of them lead to the uterus on each side where the eggs are going to be stored and released from. And this is, this is a frontal view. So here's the vagina. There's that cervix that I was telling you about. I know it looks like a really small hole, but when the baby's being delivered, that little hole has to actually expand and dilate to about 10 centimeters for the baby to come out. And that's really all happening during the laboring process. Some other structures to point out, behind the uterus and the vagina, we have the anus and the colon right here. So this is where feces is going to be pushed out from. And then this little area right here in between the anus and the vagina, that's called the perineum. It's not really widely talked about until you start going to pregnancy classes and talking about childbirth, because the perineum is an area where there's going to be a lot of stretching occurring during the process of childbirth. And guys, if you didn't know this, there is tearing involved. It doesn't always stretch. Doesn't stretch perfectly. So there is tearing involved and stitches get involved. It's a pretty painful process. And so I've been learning a lot about that in this whole process. So those are your major reproductive structures. And so just to keep in mind, because some guys are not aware of this, there are three separate openings. You have the urethra, you have the vagina, and you have the anus. So three separate openings for three very different functions. In different animals, they can actually share an opening. So birds have a cloaca where, that's the colon and the birth canal are kind of combined. But in humans, it's three. All right, let's go ahead and take a look at the other major sex organ in females, and that is the mammary glands. I don't have a picture here, but you guys probably are familiar with that. We're talking about the breasts, of course. Inside the breast, you have sacs of epithelial tissue. Remember, epithelial tissue and epithelial cells are cells that are used to line the outer parts of your skin, but also line all the inner parts of all your organs. And so inside the breast, you have multiple sacs that are lined with epithelial tissue, and these cells have a specialty of producing milk. They essentially work the same way as a sweat gland, but rather than releasing water and salts only, it's going to release water with a lot of nutrients, proteins, fats, sugars dissolved into it, and that's breast milk. And then those sacs open up through ducts that open up to the nipple, and it's not just one hole. There's actually multiple holes on the female nipple where that leads to individual sacs, and then the milk can come out of that. Now, in addition to that, you guys know that when women go through puberty, that the breasts enlarge, and the reason for that is because fat is accumulating. The adipose cells, the fat cells in the breast, are actually going to increase in size as it stores up nutrients and energy for the potential of producing breast milk. And the reason that happens during puberty and not earlier or later is because your fat is the adipose tissue is responsive to the hormone estrogen. Now, I didn't really talk about this in endocrine system lecture yesterday because we were kind of running out of time, but estrogen is one of the main female hormones that regulate the reproductive process in ladies. This doesn't mean that guys don't have it though. We do also produce estrogen, just at much smaller amounts. So guys have a lot more testosterone, less estrogen. And ladies, you have a lot more estrogen and a lot less testosterone. But when the estrogen is released, that's what causes the fatty tissue to grow, and that's why breast development occurs during puberty. That's also going to happen, obviously, during pregnancy too. So when women get pregnant, the estrogen levels are going to go up a lot more, and the breasts are also going to increase in size as they get ready to produce that breast milk. Now, you guys know from our previous lecture that the production of milk is regulated by two really important hormones, and those hormones are oxytocin and prolactin. And depending on your stage in pregnancy, and also depending on the actual frequency of breastfeeding, and when the baby is actually feeding, and the nerves and the skin of the nipple are sensing the baby's mouth sucking, that will actually send a message to the brain and causes the brain to release these hormones, and then the body will respond by producing even more milk. So milk production is actually very responsive to both the baby's touch and baby's crying. Moms will actually, if they hear their baby crying, the brain will actually send out oxytocin and prolactin, and milk will actually start to flow more. And even if the baby's not ready, there is some leaking involved there. So that's the female side. On the male side, here's the male reproductive anatomy. And I'll just go ahead and show you the pictures, and you can always jot down the notes later. But here are your major structures. Obviously, we have the two testes here. You can see inside, there's all these folds here. Okay, again, higher folding means higher surface area. And these folds here contain tubes called seminiferous tubes. That's where the sperm are actually produced. Now, the reason you want to have that high surface area is because the sperm are actually, when they're developing, the heads, the round part of the sperm that contains the nucleus, they're actually embedded within the walls of all these tubes. So more walls means more space. That means you can have more sperm being developed and matured. Outside of that, you have this storage area called the epididymis. When sperm become mature, they are migrated from the seminiferous tubes to the epididymis, and that's where they're going to finish maturing, and that's where they actually become motile, meaning that the flagella can start to swim, and that's basically where they hang out while they're waiting to be released. This tube right here that carries the sperm from the testes all the way, you can see, kind of goes up behind the bladder and then loops around and joins up into the penis, into the urethra. This tube's called the vas deferens, and that is the tube that's going to carry the sperm. You guys may have heard of older guys, once they have their kids and they don't, one form of birth control is not all in ladies, is guys can get their tubes tied, or their tubes, they get the little snip snip. It does not mean that they're removing your testicles. You do need that to keep making testosterone. All that means that they're snipping these two tubes here. So it's a pretty minor surgery. You can go in there and get the tubes cut, and they'll tie them off. And I think it is a reversible process in the future if you end up wanting to have kids again. But that's the tubes that they're talking about. And in the ladies, you can get your tubes tied too. That would be the fallopian tubes. Now down below, you have obviously the penis, and running through the middle of that, you have the urethra. Unlike women, the urethra serves two purposes. So it's going to be obviously for urinating, but it's also going to be used in the process of ejaculation to deposit that sperm. Here's a side view of it, and you can kind of see a little bit better how everything is connected. So it's kind of, starting from the gametes here, you have the testes, there's the epididymis, there's the vas deferens going all the way up. The song's a little louder, so I'm going to turn this down. So that vas deferens goes all the way around, and then you can see it joins up with the urethra. Here's our bladder kind of just hanging out. And so the bladder and the vas deferens drain into the urethra, and then that leads out the penis. Now you'll notice there's some other structures here. There's one right here, there's one right here, and there's one right here. These are accessory glands. And actually, I'm going to switch back to the notes so you can take down some things about that. So we've talked about the testes already. But the accessory glands, there are three of them that you need to know of that add secretions to the sperm. You want to understand sperm is not the same thing as semen. Okay, sperm is found in semen, but the actual fluid of semen is all contributed to by these glands. So these glands include the seminal vesicles. These are the glands that make sugar and mucus. That's a lot of the fluid of semen, as well as prostaglandins, which can cause the uterus to contract. So once the sperm goes in there, as the uterus contracts, that's going to squeeze the sperm and push them upwards towards that fallopian tube. We also have the prostate gland, which produces nutrients for the sperm. Remember, sperm need to swim, which means they need to make ATP. So semen actually does contain sugars that are broken down through cell respiration. You'll see later on the sperm have mitochondria, and they will break down that sugar and make ATP, and that's what powers the flagella. So that's going to be coming, those sugars are coming from the seminal vesicles and the prostate. And then you also have the bulbourethral urethral gland. So you should know that because we're using the same tube here, urine is slightly acidic. And so if, you know, that acid is still there when the sperm come through, that can denature the sperm. So the bulbourethral gland actually produces a slightly basic substance to neutralize that acid, and that's usually released a little bit before the sperm come through, and that way the sperm aren't affected by that acid. Okay, we're going to take a closer look at how we actually develop these gametes in both males and females, and the word genesis is used in both of these because genesis means creation. So oogenesis, whenever we see the word oo, that actually refers to the egg. So oogenesis is the development of the mature ova, also known as the egg. Now the way this happens is we start off with stem cells called oogonia. And these stem cells are diploid cells. I'll zoom in here so you can see. These diploid cells here are going to divide over and over and over using mitosis in the ovaries. And then when we are ready to actually go through meiosis, it will become a primary oocyte. And at that point, ladies, you will start going through meiosis one. Now in meiosis one, this one diploid cell is going to split into two haploid cells, right? But only one of them is actually going to move on to the next level, the next stage. The other one becomes a polar body, and that really is discarded. We don't really use that. Now the reason for this, and you'll see this happening again during meiosis two, is the egg is going to be the sole contributor to cytoplasm, to mitochondria, to a lot of the internal parts of the cell. The sperm really just contribute those 23 chromosomes. So rather than have all that cytoplasm, mitochondria divided equally amongst four eggs, which then would be really small, all those nutrients are pushed to a single egg, which is going to get everything. And then the result of that is you're going to see these polar bodies being made that are no longer used. Okay, so the primary oocyte goes through meiosis one. You get a polar body and the secondary oocyte. The secondary oocyte will then sit there and wait. And then after the process of ovulation, once the sperm actually enters, then it'll finish up meiosis two. It actually stops, I think, in metaphase at this step right here. And then it finishes up once the sperm actually gets in there. So it's kind of a fun fact. Taking a closer look at what that actually looks like, here's your oogonium in the ovary. And ladies, when you're born, you have in your ovaries thousands and millions of eggs or oogonia already there. And actually, even while you're developing in your mother's womb, they will have already, by the time you're born, they will have already developed into primary oocytes. And that kind of brings up a really sweet and beautiful picture, which is this, ladies. There was a moment in time where there were three generations in one person. What I mean by that is this. If you're a woman, if you're female biologically, when you were in your mother's womb, you were already producing these eggs, right? That's going to become your baby. And so there was a moment in time where your baby was inside you while you were inside your mother. So grandmother, mother, and daughter or son were all together in one body at a certain point in time, which is kind of cool if you think about that. Now, I mentioned that not only are there eggs, you have the eggs are actually stored inside a structure called the follicle. And the follicle is really, really important. You'll see more of this when we actually look at the ovulation cycle. But the follicle's job is to protect the egg, but also to nurse it and help the egg to mature. So what's going to happen here is when you're born with all these primary oocytes. Then when you start puberty, the release of hormones triggers every month one of those primary oocytes to be selected, and to go through the maturation process. And so that follicle will start to grow, the primary oocyte will develop and go through meiosis into a secondary oocyte, and then that follicle is going to get really, really, really big, and eventually it's going to rupture. And that moment when it ruptures is when the follicle fuses with the walls of the ovary, and the walls of the ovary actually like open up, and the egg, right, that secondary oocyte is released. That's the process of ovulation. And in women that have already gone through puberty, that's going to happen about once every month until you hit menopause. That's the role of the follicle, is to help that egg to develop and mature, and then the follicle is responsible for kind of facilitating the process of ovulation. Now, even after that, though, the follicle's job is not done. What it's going to do is it's going to develop into something called the corpus luteum. And I need to move this up just a little bit. The corpus luteum's job is to stay in the ovary, but it's going to develop into this yellow blob. Actually, corpus luteum literally means body yellow. It means the yellow body. And the corpus luteum has a really important job because it is going to send out hormones. You've heard of estrogen and progesterone. A lot of hormones of that, the estrogen and progesterone, are going to come from the corpus luteum. And that's the way of the follicle to say to the rest of the body, hey, there's this egg that I've been keeping track of, that I've been helping to grow, that egg has been released. Now, body, it's your turn to take over. And the corpus luteum is going to communicate that to the rest of the body, to the uterus, to the brain, to the breast, by releasing estrogen and progesterone. And so it's going to play a really important role, and we'll see that later on. So let me zoom out here again, kind of just to give you some bullet points to write down. So there's the development of the oogonia into the primary oocyte, and then during puberty, the FSH that's released from your brain, the follicle-stimulating hormone, will cause the secondary oocyte to start developing and go through meiosis, and it'll pause and stop at metaphase 2, and then only after fertilization happens will, let me move my face here. Only after fertilization will meiosis be completed. So then we'll go through anaphase 2, telophase 2, cytokinesis, and then the egg is done and fertilization is going to happen. Okay, and then as I mentioned, that follicle is going to play a really important role. Now, on the male side, it's a lot more straightforward because what we just need to do is make as much sperm as possible. So let me just go ahead and zoom into the picture and show you here. So here's your testicle. You can see inside there's all that folding in here. And each of those tubes, they're called seminiferous tubules. But in the cross-section of that tubule, so you can imagine if we cut that and look at it from the side, you can see that there's kind of this hollow section inside, and then there's, you know, I guess you can kind of think of it as like the medulla and the cortex. But towards the outer part here, this is the cross-section that we see here. So this is the outer part of the seminiferous tube. This is the lumen, that's the empty space in the middle. And the way this is going to work is when sperm are growing, during the process of spermatogenesis, the spermatogonia are going to be the stem cells that are going to divide through mitosis. We're going to have tons and tons and tons of these spermatogonia. And when puberty kicks in, what's going to happen is these spermatogonia are going to start to go through meiosis. So they're going to go through meiosis one, and it'll develop into a primary spermatocyte. Then it'll go through another stage of meiosis. Meiosis one produces the secondary spermatocyte. So primary spermatocytes go through meiosis one. That makes a secondary spermatocyte. And then the secondary goes through another round of meiosis to make the four spermatids, which are early sperm. You notice there's no tail yet, they're just like haploid cells. Now, as we go through this process of meiosis, you can see that physically these cells are migrating from the edge of the seminiferous tubule down towards the lumen of the tubule. And by the time we finish meiosis, you'll see that we get these four cells. They will each develop into a head of the sperm. And then from that head, you'll see a little tail start to grow out, and that tail will stick out into the lumen. And then once they are matured, they will kind of back themselves out of that wall. And now you have sperm that can swim, and they will then migrate and move from the seminiferous tubes into the epididymis, which is the storage area on the outer portion of the testicle. At that point, the sperm are ready to go. So you can see between the folding of the seminiferous tubules and then just the sheer number of spermatogonia that are in there, each testicle is able to produce a lot of sperm, right? We make 200-300 million sperm every day, potentially. And so sperm production is very, very efficient. down low here, you can see the anatomy of a sperm. Here is the head of the sperm. That's the part that would be embedded in the wall of the tubules. And that's the part that's gonna carry those 23 chromosomes. Now there's a little red cap there called the acrosome. That's a little pouch that's containing digestive enzymes. Those enzymes are gonna be needed because when that sperm hits the wall of the egg, it actually has to digest some of the proteins and the structures outside of the egg, and that will allow the sperm to burrow through and then get to the inside of the egg. So that's the acrosome. Behind it, you have the area called the midpiece, and that's just packed with mitochondria, because those mitochondria, again, are gonna take in sugars from the semen, the seminal fluids. They're gonna break down that sugar to make ATP, and that's gonna power the flagellating of this tail, this flagella, and that's what's gonna allow the sperm to swim. So to kind of sum it up here are your bullet points. Spermatogonia are the stem cells. They develop in the seminiferous tubules. Spermatocytes become spermatids, and then they're stored in the epididymis. And then we talked a little bit about sperm structure here. The acrosome, the mitochondria for the ATP, as well as the flagella that allows for motility. Okay, so kind of to wrap this section up, oogenesis differs from spermatogenesis in a couple ways. I hope you can think of some of those differences. One of the first big differences is cytokinesis is unequal, right? In females, with only one of the eggs actually getting all the cytoplasm, whereas the others become those polar bodies that are no longer used. Unlike sperm, eggs are not produced continuously throughout your life. So we'll talk about this later, but there's this thing called menopause. So from the time puberty starts, ladies, you have on average about 465 cycles that you go through. And once you finish those cycles, and think about that 465 divided by 12 months, you know, that's about, what, 30 years. So at the end, about 30 to 40 years, you're going to hit something called menopause, where the cycles actually shut down. You're not releasing eggs anymore. Because you're not going to be having kids. But for some reason, and probably that reason is that it takes, you know, pregnancy and birth takes a heavy toll on the female body, but males don't have to go through that. So we make sperm continuously through our entire life, starting from puberty and all the way into older age. The last difference is that oogenesis has long resting periods, whereas sperm are produced in interrupted sequences. So as you know, because of the monthly cycle, we're about to talk about that, the egg is only matured and released about once a month, whereas sperm are just made 24/7. And again, you can kind of think about reasons for that from an evolutionary or an ecological perspective. Okay, so let's move on to the best part of all of this, and that's the menstrual versus estrous cycles. Well, sorry, it's the menstrual and ovarian cycles. But the first thing I want to clarify is the difference between menstrual and estrous cycles. This is different depending on what kind of animal you are. So humans use menstrual cycles, okay? Whereas other animals, I think dogs, horses, pigs, they use the estrous cycle. And the difference between that is in the females, in menstrual cycles, the endometrium is shed every month. Okay, and we haven't really talked about that yet, but the endometrium is a thick layer of highly vascularized tissue that lines the inside of the uterus. And vascularized, again, means it has a lot of blood vessels there. And the purpose of that is to provide a home, a place for the embryo to implant and get nutrients in the early stages of development. And so if a woman doesn't get pregnant, then you don't need the endometrium. And as humans, that's going to get shed every month. And that's what we call the menstrual cycle, also known as your period. What this also means is, if you're menstrual, is that sexual receptivity is not limited to a certain time frame. And what I mean by that is that 12 months a year, right, as long as everything's working normally, a woman could get pregnant any time of the year as long as she's ovulating. That's going to be pretty different than the estrous cycle, where these are animals that you've heard of, like a dog goes into heat. Well, dogs are not in heat year-round, right? If a female dog is ready to reproduce, it may only be once or twice or three times a year when she goes into heat. And that's what we mean by there's a limited time frame in sexual receptivity, is that not all species are ready to, even females are not ready to reproduce at any given time. There's a certain time frame in those species. So in estrous cycles, the endometrium is not shed in order to kind of, I don't know, maybe preserve that nutrients and not lose that blood. Dogs and other animals actually reabsorb that endometrium back into the uterus, and then those nutrients can be reused later on. And then, as I mentioned, sexual receptivity is limited to a heat period. And so those of you guys that are gonna be a vet one day, you'll learn a lot about that. Now, in both cases, ovulation is going to occur only after the endometrium has started to thicken. Okay, and this is a really, really important point that we're going to look at in the next slide, is that ovulation, again, which is the release of the egg, has to be timed just right, right? Because if you think about this, like ovulation happens on day 14. Okay, you'll see a calendar here on a 28-day cycle. On day 14, ovulation happens, but fertilization doesn't necessarily happen right away. The sperm might not get to the egg right as it's being released. It may take a couple of days, and then it may take another day for that embryo, that zygote, to work its way down to the uterus. So you have to time it just right so that by the time that baby arrives in the uterus is ready to receive that baby by thickening that endometrium. And so there's some syncing that has to take place between what's happening in the ovaries and what's happening in the uterus. And that's what we're gonna talk about here, the female reproductive cycle. This is my favorite thing to teach, just because I think it's so fascinating of how all these things line up. And especially, you know, now that, you know, we've gone through this whole process of like getting pregnant and going through pregnancy, and now we're on the cusp of childbirth. I can say, fellows, your partners will really, really appreciate it if you take the time to understand what's going on in their body, because it's a lot. It's really, really hard on the woman's body to carry a baby and then also to give birth to it. And so the more you can understand about how that works, the more you can support and be understanding and maybe even be an advocate, just understanding like what's happening medically, right? When they give certain drugs, like how is that going to interact with this? So I'm not going to give you all the data, the bullet points right now. You can always download that later. I just want to go right to the picture. So let's start with this box C right here. And this comes right out of your book, so you can look along if you need to. Box C is talking about something called the ovarian cycle. And this is the cycle that we go through. It's a 28-day cycle, which we can see at the... Oh, you can't see it because it's cut off in the video. Here you go. It starts with day 0 and it ends with day 28. Okay. And the ovarian cycle works like this. On day 0, one follicle is going to be selected out of the millions that you have in your ovaries. It's going to be told to start to grow and develop and mature that egg. Okay, so that egg is going to mature. It's going to start to go through meiosis 2. It's going to pause at metaphase, but that follicle is going to mature. And over the first 2 weeks, by day 14, that follicle and the egg's fully mature, and the follicle is going to rupture, and it's going to release that egg into the fallopian tube. And that moment is ovulation. That's what this dotted line you see going from the top to bottom represents. That's day 14. That's the ovulation process happening. Okay. Now, after that moment, that egg is now going to travel down that fallopian tube and hope to run into a sperm that can fertilize it, and then it'll grow into a baby, into an embryo. But as I mentioned, even after the egg is released, the corpus luteum is going to form from that old follicle, okay? And that corpus luteum is going to hang out for the next 2 weeks, and it's going to crank out tons of estrogen and progesterone to tell the body what to do. And we'll come back to that in a little bit. Now, the first thing I want to talk about is how this process is regulated, right? Because how does the woman's body know to do this over the course of 14 days, and then to have the corpus luteum do that over the next 14 days? And why is it on average a 28-day cycle? Well, the reason for that is because it's actually controlled by the brain. Remember, the brain, going all the way to the top here, has a region called the hypothalamus, which regulates homeostasis, but it also regulates a lot of your reproduction. And so the brain is the one that's actually keeping track of the days by paying attention to all kinds of cues. And depending on what kind of animal you are, these cues could be changes in temperature, they could be changes in the length of the day, like how long the days versus the nights are. But all these different cues come in, and your age obviously is part of it. And when the time comes, what the brain will do is the hypothalamus will release something called gonadotropin-releasing hormone, or GnRH. And that will communicate to the anterior pituitary gland that it's time to start ovulation. The anterior pituitary gland then responds by releasing two tropic hormones, FSH, follicle-stimulating hormone, and you can see why we call it that now, and luteinizing hormone, which is LH. And that gets put into the bloodstream. That's going to travel from the brain through the blood and then eventually arrive at the ovaries. And you can see what happens, the way we kind of like sync this and control all this, is that as we get closer and closer to ovulation, notice what happens right before ovulation. Look at this graph. What happens right before the egg is released? Well, you see this spike, especially LH levels go way up and FSH levels also go up a little bit. Okay? And that spike is the way of the brain to communicate with the ovary, saying, okay, when the LH levels spike, you should be basically ready to release that egg. This is the reason why when women are trying to get pregnant, one of the things they can do is try to track their ovulation cycles. And I know it sounds funny as young people, because as young people, like the priority is to not get pregnant. But when you get older, you'll find that women actually, it's actually harder than you think to get pregnant. I'm not saying don't use birth control or be careful about all that stuff, but it's funny, like when you want to get pregnant, it actually takes some work, you know? And so some women, if they're having trouble, you know, figuring out when they're actually ovulating, you can buy ovulation test strips. They're actually really cheap on Amazon now. We got like 50 of them for $20. But what you do is you just pee on the little stick every day and you look for the color to change. And the chemicals in there, what they're doing is they're responding to specifically to LH. So, you know, on day one or day two, you're peeing on that stick, nothing's happening, no color is changing. But by day 12 or day 13, you pee on it and the colors start to change. And actually over the day or two, the colors become more and more clear. What that's telling you is that the LH levels are on their way up, they're spiking, and that the ovulation is gonna happen in the next 24 to 48 hours. So that's how a lot of how those tests work. They're really just testing for the presence of some hormone. So again, what you're testing really is the communication between the brain and the ovary, and that's gonna regulate the timing of this ovarian cycle, okay? Now, down below, we have the other piece of this. And the way this works is, and gosh, it's already 40 minutes. I'm not doing this faster than I did. It might even take more time. Whatever, sorry, the last one, YOLO. But remember I told you guys that once ovulation happens, the endometrium in the uterus has to be ready to receive that. So you can see if we follow the dotted line on day 14 down here, by the time we get to the uterus, you can see the endometrium is pretty much ready to go to receive that baby, right? But the endometrium is going through its own cycle as well. We'll start actually at day 28 here. On day 28, the endometrium, at the very end of the last cycle, the endometrium is already pretty thick. And if pregnancy doesn't happen, what the endometrium is looking for is a hormone, I'll talk about this in a little bit, that is released by the baby itself. And that baby's gonna release this hormone that tells the body, hey, I'm here, I'm pregnant, you're pregnant now, don't get rid of the endometrium, and it'll stay thick for the duration of the pregnancy. But if there's not that hormone being released, if the body doesn't sense that, then it'll say, well, we don't need this endometrium, and it'll shed it. And that's where we restart the cycle on day zero of the cycle, the first 5 days, that's the menstrual flow phase. And that's when women, you're gonna get your period because you're not using that endometrium. After the first 4 or 5 days though, you hit that bottom thickness, that the endometrium's gone, but immediately you have to start getting ready to thicken it again. Because why? In about, doing the math here, in 9 days, another egg is gonna come out. So immediately after the menstrual cycle begins, the endometrium will start to thicken again and prepare for that egg. Now again, how does it know to do that? Because all of this is timed out and choreographed by your hormones. So remember, I told you here that the follicle's job is not only to watch over that egg, it's also to communicate with the uterus about what's going on. So you can see that as the follicle is growing and maturing, the follicle itself is actually releasing are two important hormones. That's estrogen and progesterone. Estrogen's the blue line, progesterone's the orange line. And you can see that early on in the first 14 days of the cycle, estrogen levels and progesterone levels are going up and up and up, and actually progesterone actually peaks at the same time that the LH is peaking. And that lines up all these cycles here so that the egg is being released at the same time as the endometrium is being thickened. Then after that, when the follicle becomes the corpus luteum, the progesterone levels drop, but the estrogen levels go way up, and that is going to cause the endometrium to thicken even more. And this is the reason why, ladies, you know, people make kind of crude and mean jokes about, like, you know, PMS and being emotional and stuff, but there is a reason why you may feel really hormonal, whatever that looks like for each individual person. It's because in this 28 cycle, you can see there are tons of hormones. There's 4 major hormones surging through your bloodstream at any given time. You have estrogen, you have progesterone from the follicle, and you have LH and FSH from the pituitary gland. And all of that is working really hard to sync up these two cycles of the ovarian cycle and the menstrual cycle to make sure that your body is ready to be receptive to an embryo should you get pregnant. So that is kind of the big picture of how the cycle works. It's super awesome, really fascinating to me. And you know, the thing is, a lot of ladies, so you've had your period for several years now, but a lot of people don't actually understand how it's happening or why it happens the way it does. And so hopefully understanding how hormones work and how, you know, all these different parts talk to each other, that hopefully it gives you some clarity into what's going on. Okay, so there are your bullet points. You can pause the video if you want to jot down some notes here. We mentioned at the end here about menopause. The cycle, this 0 to 28 cycle, is going to happen on average about 465 times before you go into menopause. Of course, that can vary. Some ladies have longer cycles, some have shorter cycles, and some cycles can be really irregular, which is why women will actually get prescriptions for birth control from their doctors. It's not necessarily because they don't want to get pregnant. Birth control often just contains really high levels of estrogen and progesterone, and that can help to normalize the cycle and make it more predictable for you. Speaking of birth control, let's just talk about that really quick. A lot of birth control has a lot of estrogen and progesterone, and the reason why it works to prevent pregnancy is because estrogen and progesterone levels are at the highest after ovulation. So if you're taking a birth control pill, and guys, if you didn't know this, ladies have to take this basically every single day except for the week of their period. But if you're taking estrogen or progesterone, these levels are really, really high. And what happens is negative feedback kicks in, right? The estrogen and progesterone go into the blood, they go up to the brain, and they tell the brain, hey, ovulation has already happened, do not release any more GnRH. And so what that means is high levels of estrogen and progesterone mean low levels of FSH and LH, which means that the egg is not gonna be matured and the follicle is not gonna ovulate. And so the idea with this is keeping these hormone levels high will actually, using negative feedback, prevent the egg from being released, right? And that's why you're less likely to get pregnant. Now, this is not 100%, but it is generally pretty effective by preventing that ovulation from happening, okay? So that's birth control, but you should also know many ladies take birth control just to normalize the cycle, because everybody's body is a little bit different. So yeah, birth control prescription is not an indicator of sexual activity or anything like that. Okay, in the males, I'm gonna go over this really fast. It's pretty straightforward. Here you wanna make sperm, you wanna develop your secondary characteristics, and what helps you do that is testosterone. But where does the testosterone actually come from? It's produced by a cell in your testes called a Leydig cell. And the Leydig cell is gonna rely on the same hormones as the ladies use, which is LH and FSH. So guys, when you start puberty, your hypothalamus goes, oh, you're 12, you're 13, it's time. It releases GnRH, gonadotropin releasing hormone. The anterior pituitary gland releases LH and FSH. That goes in your bloodstream. And then that causes your Leydig cells and your Sertoli cells to make testosterone and begin spermatogenesis. Testosterone also goes into your bloodstream and promotes secondary sex characteristics like your voice getting deeper, the growth of facial hair, more muscle development, all those kinds of things. So guys, we're pretty straightforward with that. And I think I'm gonna finish with this just because we're kind of running out of time. You can always read up on your own with pregnancy. But I do wanna mention really quickly that it's really cool when fertilization happens, it's not just the mom running the whole show, okay? At a certain point, actually pretty early on, the baby starts to run the show, because the baby is the one that's gonna make a lot of the really important calls. And so when when fertilization happens, you guys know the cell divides over and over and over into eventually into a blastocyst, right? That blastocyst right here will actually release a hormone called human chorionic gonadotropin, otherwise known as HCG. And that's the hormone I was telling you about earlier. That's the way that the baby can actually tell the mom's body to say, hey mom, I'm here, I'm pregnant, don't shed the endometrium, I need it to survive. And as the baby grows, it's gonna actually produce even more and more and more HCG. And that is actually the other hormone that is used to be detected in the other test, which is the pregnancy test. So you guys have seen, you know, in movies that they pee on that little stick for the pregnancy test, and it says positive or negative. It doesn't really matter if it's positive or negative. The color change is a chemical reaction that is triggered in response to the HCG hormone. And so that's what you're detecting during that pregnancy test, okay? It essentially acts like a pituitary LH to maintain the secretion of progesterone and estrogen by the corpus luteum. So that's the baby's way of talking to the corpus luteum to say, I'm here, please proceed with pregnancy. And of course, if you have a lot of ACG, that also, through negative feedback loops, is gonna cause more estrogen progesterone to be produced, which then causes the pituitary gland to shut down, and then menstruation stops. And that's why when a woman gets pregnant, she's going to miss her period. That's one of the earliest indicators that you're pregnant, is that your period doesn't come because all the hormones are now switched over to pregnancy mode. And then, as I mentioned, HCG can be detected by pregnancy tests. Let's see, I think I wanted to stop there, but I don't want to stop because there's so much cool stuff. Okay, I'm going to keep going with this. You know, whatever. If you want to watch the rest of this later, you can, or just go through it. I'm going to keep going. This is my last one. In fetal development, you guys know, hopefully, that there are three trimesters, and these three trimesters are about 13 weeks each. So we're in the week 39 right now. So we're basically full term. 40 weeks is considered full term. 39 is full term. I've been corrected. So we're full term right now, which means we're getting ready for labor. And you know, there's all kinds of apps and stuff. You can see what's going on as the baby develops. I do want to point out though, in this picture, you can see in this last picture, the baby looks like it's ready to come out. This is what the baby only looks like at just 20 weeks. Okay. So, there's still a lot of development going on that needs to take place, but you can see it's already got fingers, it's already got toes, it's got a face, the genitalia already are visible. You can actually tell the gender by 20 weeks. And even at 5 weeks, just 1 month in, you can see the head's already formed, little buds for the feet and the hands, and even the heart has already formed and is already beating and pumping blood. You can actually see some of the blood vessels moving through the head there. So really amazing how much happens that early on during fetal development. Now, the thing I didn't want to skip over was talking about this placenta, because this is one of the most fascinating parts to me about pregnancy, is the beautiful aspect of how mom is able to provide for the baby during those 9 months of pregnancy. And as you guys know, we all have an umbilical cord, right? That's where your belly button's hooked up to. And the umbilical cord is going to contain two arteries and one vein. And they actually look kind of like a Mickey Mouse if you look at a cross-section of it. But that umbilical cord is going to carry all the blood from the body, from the baby's body, to the mom, where all the exchange is going to take place. And that is the role of the placenta, right? Just like any animal or any organism, the baby needs certain inputs to survive. It needs oxygen, it needs sugars, it needs proteins and fats, nucleic acids, and it has to be able to get rid of its waste, primarily urea. But the baby can't do any of that on its own, right? It's not eating, it's not breathing. I don't know if you knew that. Babies cannot breathe because they're in the umbilical, in the amniotic fluid. They're just floating there. And they do pee to a certain extent. They actually can urinate in utero, but we also don't want too much of that urine to be in there because that can be toxic to the baby, right? That urea, that ammonia is not good for them. So the blood's gonna carry that away. And how does that happen? Well, let's zoom in here. Here's the umbilical cord. They kind of cut it off here. And the umbilical cord, when it comes into this area called the placenta, it's like this bag that's like filled with vascular tissue. The arteries and the veins are going to break up into huge capillary beds that extend all throughout the placenta. You can see all these are capillary beds here. These capillary beds are bathed by blood, but not from the mom, not from the baby. This is from the mom. So coming from the mom's side, this is the maternal artery and maternal veins, and the veins are going to actually, and arteries are going to dump out into this space here. That is where the maternal blood is gonna pool around the capillary bed. So literally, your mom's blood is surrounding your capillary beds when you're in utero. And what that does is, you know, because of the capillary beds, they have a high surface area. There's all these epithelial cells here that can allow for the transfer of all the oxygen nutrients that you need, as well as the dumping of the waste. And then the veins are gonna carry that away from this placenta back to the baby, and that's going to provide the baby with everything that it needs. That's a really beautiful and really awesome picture of like what happens during pregnancy. And that's why, like, pregnant women, like, everything slows down. You get more tired, you might get more hungry, you might get more thirsty, because the baby is literally taking all your nutrients, all your oxygen, all your water, all your calcium. We've talked about how the bones kind of get empty to their calcium to help make the baby's bones. All that's happening during those 9 months of pregnancy. This picture also does a really good job of showing you kind of like what's happening just in terms of anatomy. You can see, remember, the uterus was really, really small when you weren't pregnant, but now the uterus has ballooned. It's huge. This actually takes up a lot more, as much space as the baby within the mother's womb. And then there's that cervix. You can see this is where the baby's going to need to get pushed out of. That's going to have to open up to 10 centimeters. Taking a closer look, this is the amniotic sac filled with amniotic fluid. That's also called the bag of waters. And so you've heard of people saying that their bag of water broke, and literally, like, you'll get, it's not like a waterfall, but you'll get a gush of water coming out. And that's a really early indicator that the baby is on its way. Last thing about the placenta that's just kind of interesting is a lot of people don't know this, but when you give birth to a baby that and the baby comes out, you're not done yet. There's a second birth called the afterbirth, and what you have to push out is the actual placenta. That's not needed anymore. That has to come out. And so when the baby, I learned through birthing classes that when after the baby comes out, the midwife or the nurse will actually give the mom massages on her belly. It's not the good kind of massage. It's actually quite painful. But what you're trying to do is dislodge that placenta from the wall of the uterus so that the placenta can come out safely. Remember, this is highly, highly vascularized, right? All this placenta is hooked up to mom's blood vessels. So that process is actually pretty bloody, and the mom can potentially lose a lot of blood. That's why back in the old days, a lot of women would actually die during childbirth. It's not because the baby got stuck and the mom died. A lot of it is because there would be a lot of bleeding and a lot of secondary infection as they're trying to get rid of that placenta. So that placenta is going to get pushed out also, and usually you just discard it, but it is a certain practice in certain cultures, or if you're a little more like, I don't know, natural. there are some people out there that believe the placenta, just because of the blood in there and the nutrients and also the hormones there, can also be nutritious to the mom and helps, you know, mom recover with postpartum and also with breast milk production. So we were told at our class that if you want to take the placenta home, you got to bring your own containers. You bring a Tupperware or a Ziploc bag. But if you want to look up a picture, it's just big. It's like a one big, like big bloody sack. I know it sounds really gross, but you know, you can take that home, and there are companies that you can ship it to, and they'll dry it out for you, make, you know, tablets, and you can eat them as pills, or some people dry it out and actually cook it and eat it. We're not going to be doing that, but some people do that. It's kind of whatever you're into, but that's the deal with the placenta. That's the afterbirth. Super cool. And again, as you're thinking about this, maybe think about all, you know, hopefully it brings a little more appreciation for what you're mom had to go through to get you here, and also what she did for you during those 9 months. Last thing, just because this is probably the next thing we're going to be looking at, is the childbirth process. And we've talked about this already, that there's a positive positive feedback cycle of oxytocin that triggers the birth process. So you can see here, oxytocin is released. That actually, estrogen also plays a role. The ovaries are also telling the mom's body that it's time. And that's the estrogen is what's going to induce the oxytocin receptors on the uterus and kind of activate them. And now the oxytocin is released from the pituitary gland. That's going to stimulate the uterus to contract. The placenta itself is actually going to make a hormone called prostaglandin that's the actual one that causes the contraction of the uterus. Remember, prostaglandins are also contained in semen. So during sex, the semen from the male can also cause the uterus to contract. And that purpose was very different. That was to push the sperm up towards the egg. This time the prostaglandins are being released to push the baby out. And of course, as the uterus contracts more, then through positive feedback, through sensory neurons in your muscle of the uterus, that's going to send a message to the brain saying, hey, it's time, make more oxytocin. And then that causes even more of this to happen. So that cycle is going to go and go and go and go. And that's basically the process of labor. And the baby is going to get pushed out. And then you can see the placenta is also going to detach and come out too there at the end. So I know this actually was longer by almost 10 minutes than the original one, but I don't really care. I hope you guys learned something new and enjoyed that. And again, this is all like super real and personal to us right now, which just makes it all that much more exciting to teach. So thanks for sticking around this long. Hope you liked it. And you're headed into spring break tomorrow. So whatever that looks like, enjoy it. Even if you don't have schoolwork, if I were you, trying to make a plan for yourself, exercise, keep socializing, reach out to people, stay connected, stay healthy. All right. I will see you on the other side, probably with a baby. So you guys take care. I miss you all. And I'll see you later. Bye.